catchy little thing I came up with, stylized after one of the keynotes here, Matt Miller. I met Matt Miller last summer at ISTE, and I was like, hey, check out the sticker. And I'm like, is he going to get mad at me for like copyright infringement? So I was real nervous, and he was like, oh my God, that's the coolest thing ever. It's going right on my laptop. So that was a huge win for me last summer. So Matt Miller accepted my little spin on his Ditch That Textbook spiel. So welcome to Ditch That Copier. We're going to app smash our way towards paperless. So we have the Hulk there smashing some apps. If you don't know what an app smash is, we'll start off with a quick little definition. An app smash is when you use two or more apps in concert with one another to come up with a very innovative and empowering learning experience. So without further ado, let's get this party started. So again, my name is Adam Juarez. I'm the tech integration coach from Cutler Orosi Joint Unified School District. Most of you here are like, except for like three people in the room for sure, like where the heck is that? It's literally in the middle of nowhere. So let me give you a quick geography lesson. We are about right in the center of California, nestled against the Sierra Nevada Mountains, about halfway between Fresno and Visalia. I can literally be in the giant sequoias in 45 minutes from my office. Interesting fact about the community I serve, it's about 95% Hispanic. They're the children of Mexican migrant farm workers, about 4.5% Filipino. And I can count all the white students I've ever taught on one hand. That's the demographic that I serve. They have their own challenges, and part of what I do here was designed to meet the needs of those kids. It's a very impoverished town. Again, we're 45 minutes from one of nature's wonders, the giant sequoias. Majority of my kids have never even been there. So just a quick background on me. I serve El Monte Middle School and Orosi High School. So I'm a grade 6 through 12 technology integration coach. I've taught history for one way or another for over 10 years, and about 3 years in this capacity. As you can tell, I have a lot of certifications. I've been very busy. All but one of those have happened in the last 18 months. This wasn't the plan. It just kind of happened. So if you're interested in this whole ed tech game, anybody can do it. About 2 years ago, I became Google certified level 1, and a year later, level 2, and then it just snowballed from there. I became a certified trainer, and last August, I became a Google certified innovator. That's one of the highest honors Google gives to educators. There's less than 1,500 in the world, and we have, counting me, there's two others in the room right now, so it's an honor to have that certification, and a lot of what I'm going to teach you today is part of my Google Innovator project, which is called the Cardinal Innovation Center, which you see up there. To get a hold of me, you can always email me. This is my email right here. You have my website. If you're on to the slides, then you're already on to my website. That's where I house all my resources. And there's a page where you can contact me. There's five ways to get a hold of me. Twitter is the easiest way to get a hold of me. You have my Twitter handle up there, at Tech Coach Juarez. Follow me. I will follow back. Got to grow that PLN. I'm here today because of my PLN. Without that, I wouldn't be here speaking in front of you. So I've always learned from teachers the best, the ones who let me get to know them a little bit. It just made me feel more comfortable. I might find something I identify with them. So you're going to get to know me in a nutshell very briefly. So again, my name's Adam, and these are my three, my pride and joy, my three beautiful daughters. Ashley on the left, she's age 6. We call her the bandit, because when she learned how to walk, she would steal your shoes and run. So she became the bandit. In the middle, we have Ariel. She's 5. We call her the ninja. No, that's not a typo. Because when she was learning how to walk, she was very much like a ninja. She would just appear and then disappear. She was just stealth. And somehow she magically appears in my bed every night. But Ashley couldn't say ninja. It came out ninja, so the name stuck. And on the right, we have Andrina, a.k.a. the animal. So think of the Muppets, and you know what I'm talking about. She's all over the place. I want to rename her Wolverine because a week before Christmas this last year, she had open-heart surgery to fix her atrial septal defect. A week later, she was already home jumping on the couch. A week later, the doctor said, okay, she's good to go. She doesn't need to be on the medication anymore. And at her 6-week follow-up, complete 100% recovery. I was like, how do you recover so quickly? The kid's just amazing. So she's my animal. Again, we have the logos for the schools I serve, El Monte Middle School and Orosi High School. I am a rabid Manchester United supporter. And yes, it is my fault, Neil. I am the world's foremost expert on Fresno State football. Some of you are like, oh yeah, Fresno State, whatever, but my dad was the equipment manager for Fresno State sports for 25 years, so my childhood consisted of me getting picked up from school by my dad, then going back to the locker room every day after school. It was a great way to grow up. Many of my older brothers went on to the NFL, Major League Baseball, NBA. Oh, the projector died. That's all right, we fell forward. Oh, the power go up? All right, typical tip conference. Let's see, if I just unplug it. That usually works. Oh, this is a short, might be a short on the, is it back here? Let's see. Oh man, there's too many back there. I don't know if we have a tech guy to. Oh, did he? All right, cool. All right, so yes, we're just gonna fail forward. So if you can follow along on my slides, see that's why we do this. So if there's someone here who just walked in, show them how to get there so you can follow along. So, all right. So like I said, I was the foremost expert at Fresno State football. A lot of my friends went on to the NFL, NBA, Major League Baseball. Very cool way to grow up. Even the AV guy is a former Bulldog. Even the executive director of Q is a former Bulldog football player. So it's a great way to grow up. All right. So, again, share on social media. Using the hashtags, obviously, Q18. And if you're following along on this slide, hashtag CV Tech Talk. I'm the proud co-founder of this weekly Twitter chat every Wednesday at 7 p.m. We're talking technology and pedagogy. Everyone's invited. The CV stands for Central Valley, for the Central Valley of California. We have regulars across the country now. We never expected that to happen. I have my lovely co-founder over here. We're very proud of that. And yeah, join us. It's a great way to grow your PLN and get some free PD every week. So again, if we move on to the next slide there, what to expect. So DigTechCopier is about some tips and ideas to minimize the amount of paper consumed in the classroom. I remember years ago when I first became a teacher, going on 13 years now, I would just kind of marveled on how much paper gets used and how I give a kid some work, they get it back, where does it end up? In the round file. One kid might take it and put it on the fridge, but eventually it's going to make its way into the trash can. I just think that's such a waste. And I'm not a big fan of mass-produced lessons, canned lessons. And if you are on the copier a lot, it's a lot of times those are mass-produced. I'm not saying the copier is going to go away. It's a tool. We're not going to blame the tool. But we're going to talk about ways to be more efficient with your time. The copier, if we go on to the next slide here, again, where we're going, we don't need copiers. I love that one. So if we go on to the next one over there, think of the copier can be like an anchor. It's holding us back. This thing slowing us in the pursuit of our goals because the copier can, I remember when I first became a tech coach, first thing you gotta do as a coach is find a way and in with those, with teachers. How are you gonna make their life easier? And I remember one of the biggest problems I had as a teacher, fighting for that copier. My God, it was such a pain. I had to wait in line. I'm sitting there waiting in line. I'm not thinking about how I can empower students. I'm just pissed off that I have to wait. And then I finally get there. Oh, it's out of toner. Maybe you pull it out, you shake it, and you get a little bit more life out of the toner. But you go like crap all over your hands. Oh, so annoying. Or it gets jammed. Some one tiny little particle of paper is stuck deep inside the copier somewhere, and you got to get in there and find it. So annoying. So many lessons I had planned just got canned because I couldn't make the copies. So I started thinking, all right, what can I do as a tech coach to make the life of my teachers I serve easier? So I came up with this Ditch That Copier idea to come up with ways to leverage. I mean, our school started putting all this money into technology. And when we first started, our superintendent did a walkthrough, and we had these Chromebook carts, where they called them cows. Computers on wheels, that's what we used to call them. And she made something that really kind of stuck with me. She says, the cows are out the pasture. Why are you sitting there giving all these worksheets when you have a Chromebook cart sitting right there collecting dust? So that really lit a fire under me to really help teachers to leverage that tool there and figure out what to do. So this session is going to be a lot of ideas to really maximize your efficiency using whatever kind of technology you have in class, whether it's a Chromebook cart, it's a computer lab, iPads, or whatever you have available. So again, the copier, it's a big drain. It's a big weight. It's a big drain on your time. What do we wish we had a lot more of? Time. If we had more time, we can design learning experiences that are innovative and empowering to students. So again, this is the philosophical part of this. So if we move on to the next one. All right, cool. Thank you very much. They're working hard. All right. Yes. Success. We're back. There we go. So again, why we need more time. One of my sayings, and I made this up on the fly in a session I did last year, and I'm like, wow, that's a pretty good one. People liked it. It's a hashtag I made. It's called always in beta. Because as long as I'm in beta, I'm always improving. I'm always innovating. It represents a growth mindset. And if I have more time to continue to hone my craft, I'm always going to be in beta, and I'll be able to, because the kids I serve now are so much different than the kids I started serving 13 years ago. My first kids I ever taught, they wanted to be my friend on MySpace. And then Facebook came along. And then Instagram. They never really, when I was teaching middle school, nobody really was on Twitter. And now it's Snapchat. So that right there just kind of tells you how the kids are evolving. And one of the first things I was told by a coworker years ago in the beginning, they're like, hey, just, you know, the first year is going to be rough, but after that you have all these resources you made. Just go to the filing cabinet, pull it out, and it's just repeat. And at first, I remember I got, year three, I got to that point. I'm like, yes, I made it. But it didn't feel right. I kept tweaking it and tweaking. I'm like, I got to always be in beta. I have to reiterate everything. I'll come up with new iterations. So as you can see, I'm a big fan of Wu-Tang. These shirts are brand new. Got unveiled last night at Q Karaoke. Limited edition. And one of the Wu-Tang members you see up there, the RZA, he calls himself Bobby Digital, he would say, you need time to design witty, unpredictable learning experiences. Witty, unpredictable is a mantra of Wu-Tang that I've always kind of really identified with. Because if you're witty and predictable, you're going to engage with students. You're going to empower those kids. And one big obstacle towards achieving that goal is the copy machine. So we'll start off here with our first little trick here, digital note-taking. A lot of the research will say, hey, writing it down, pencil and paper, you know, brain research will say that's a good way, that's probably the most desirable way for kids to learn. And I'm not knocking writing things down, but kids need to be good at both. They got to be able to take notes digitally and in pencil and paper. And I think for the most part, we do a good job of getting them writing things down. But we live in a digital world. So what's the advantages of digital note taking? Well, as a teacher, a lot of teachers will collect notes as part of their grading. Well, when I used to do that, I used to hate reading their bad handwriting. To the point right now, I don't have glasses yet, but I'll probably need them earlier than I would have if I didn't spend years reading all their horrible handwriting. We have the convenience of the cloud. We should understand how the cloud works. I love that GIF there of Olaf, because it really represents what the way the cloud works. When I did my master's degree, it was completely online. Not one piece of paper was used, not one pencil was used. Very proud of that. And all my notes were in the cloud. This is before I got into Google. It was all done on Microsoft OneNote. But the thing is, I will never lose those notes. It'd be very hard for me to lose those notes. When I was in college, I went back to my old high school to coach as assistant soccer coach. And at this time in my life, I was I wouldn't say I was an aspiring rapper, but me and my friends used to write rhymes in notebooks. I kept this notebook with me all the time, and I think of something, I write it down. Well, we go to a rally, and I'm in the gym, and we head out to practice after, and that notebook was gone. I had some really cool stuff I wrote there that I wish I had. I'll never get back. But in the cloud, if I save it in Google Drive or in OneNote or any other cloud format, all I got to do is find, if my lightning strikes my laptop, go grab another one, log back in, it's right where I left off. And that's such a huge 21st century skill to have. When you're taking notes digitally, you can do things you can't do with paper and pencil, such as the ability to add graphics and rich media. I mean, I think back now, like when I was in college, when I was in high school, if I could add links and YouTube videos to my notes, how much more powerful my notes would have been. How much more enjoyable it would have been to review those notes. And again, they're available on a variety of platforms. It doesn't matter if you're an Android or an iOS person. It doesn't matter if you like Mac, if you like PCs, or if you want a Chromebook. They're available on so many different platforms. You have it with you. You don't have to carry your laptop with you. Use the laptop at work. You go log in at home. It's waiting right there for you. You can take notes on your phone. A lot of times our kids, their phones are a toy. They use it to entertain themselves. But what if we taught them to take notes digitally, and all of a sudden we begin teaching them how to leverage this powerful tool? It's not just a toy anymore. It becomes a tool. And that's I think, an often overlooked skill for kids these days. So let's go ahead and start with one of our first apps here, Google Keep. Any Google Keep users here? Not a day goes by where I don't use Google Keep. It is, using hip-hop terms, it is one of the most slept-on apps in all of G Suite. People don't realize it's there. But Google Keep is amazing. I call it sticky notes on steroids. Okay, it's real simple. We have a couple GIFs here that kind of shows you how they work. You can take just regular notes on a blank notepad. You can do check boxes that automatically can be crossed out for you. But the power of it for students and for you as well, for your own efficiency, is the reminders. How many of you in the morning, you're getting ready for work and you think it's something you got to do, and then you get to work and you forget what it was? It's happened to all of us. I know it has. So when I started using Google Keep, that wasn't a problem anymore. Because Google Keep, I can do location-based reminders. Using the power of Google Maps, when I make my notes, I can put the address in the location-based reminder. When I get to the parking lot at school, boom, my phone buzzes, it's right there. And I remember. Do the same thing when I'm going home. Yep, I can put a grocery list, type in the name of the grocery store. When I get there it is. It's making my life easier. Google Keep, recently, in the last year or so, has really integrated deeply with Google Docs. You've always been able to start a note in Keep and then push it to a doc and continue. It allows you to jumpstart the writing process. So think if you're doing a gallery walk with kids and you want them to start writing about it, they can take their Chromebooks or even their phones and go to each station, take notes on Keep. And then when they get back to their seats, they can easily take those notes, drop them onto a doc, and boom, they start writing. It's very, very convenient. Google Keep has kind of doubled down on that, where now when you're in Google Docs, if you click on the tools, you can open up the Keep notepad, and it opens up in a side pane for you guys, on this side of your screen. And then you see all your notes, and you can start dragging those notes one by one into your doc. So again, it's really integrated well with Google Docs, and recently with Google Slides. We did a little app smash with that, where we took kids using touchscreen Chromebooks and they would use the drawing function on the touchscreen Chromebook and Keep, and they would write out their math problems. They would open up Slides, put Keep on the side, and drag their work onto a slide and submit their work. Again, completely took paper out of the equation. Now again, I'm gonna tell you, paperless is not the goal. Saving time so you can be more design more empowering learning experiences is the goal. So I'm going to give you guys about a minute or so to go ahead and play around with Google Keep. Talk to somebody, share your experience with Keep. About a minute. Go ahead and explore Keep if you haven't done so already. And about a minute, we'll continue.
Yes, you can. Can I kick it?
Yes, you can.
Getting mentioned on the tip of the vibe was rock and roll to the beat.
you guys got a chance to take a look at Keep if you haven't done so yet. So next thing I'm going to talk to you about when it comes to digital note-taking, the next step is naming conventions. This is something kids really don't know yet. I look at a lot of kids' Google Drives, and here's what I see. Untitled document, untitled document, untitled document. And I go to review their work, and it's like some random gibberish from something that they did in the wrong class. And I'm like, hey, you submitted the wrong thing. Well, I couldn't find it. Well, you need to learn how to title your documents better. Here's a story I tell kids when I teach them the naming convention that I've chosen. I tell them about my old college roommate and how he stayed up real late one night, met his 11:59 p.m. deadline, submitted his work online. He felt really good. It was a great essay he wrote. I know because I helped him edit it. And he... We get to class on Monday, and the professor's like, dude, it's a wrong file. That's from a different class. And he's like, oh, my bad. I named it wrong. And I'll go back and resubmit. He's like, no, you get a zero. Too bad. So I tell students, you're going to run into professors like that. They have that ego. Like, hey, you meet my deadline, and that's it. So don't be a casualty. So naming conventions is really something that has to be taught when we're taking notes digitally. We have an example there on the bottom. I like to use underscores. Kids are familiar with underscores. And this naming convention really allows you to search a lot easier. So if I can just type in chapter one, then it filters everything with chapter one. If I want to look for something for just section one or notes, then using that style of naming convention, it'll really help kids find their files a lot quicker. But Google Docs and Drive, I mean, it's the perfect marriage for taking notes digitally. Completely the perfect marriage. It makes things so much easier. But again, if they're not naming their stuff correctly, they're not organizing their drive with folders, they're gonna be like my old friend who accidentally uploaded the wrong file. We have any Avid teachers here? Anybody familiar with Avid? Avid's big time where I work. We're a national demonstration school, so we get Cornell notes shoved down our throats. I'm not the biggest fan of Cornell notes, but I've been working with our Avid people, and I have right there, if you're on the resources, that's a link you can click on. You can make a copy of a Cornell notes template I made. Honestly, anybody can make it up. You just do a table in Docs or in Microsoft Word. Very easy to use. When it comes to taking notes, I talked earlier about how, there's lots of research about how superior it is for kids to actually write. Pencil and paper, actually write it out because it develops different pathways in the brain. Again, you can still do that and do it digitally. I mean, having kids writing with styluses may not be the most efficient way to take notes. Kids will lose them, let's be honest. But a good buddy of mine here, my doppelganger, Joe Marquez, came up with this brilliant hack. You guys familiar with a rocket book? Rocket books are amazing. If you don't know what that is, rocket books are these pretty much endless notebooks that at the bottom of each page, if you look closely enough, there you see a little QR code and some symbols. You use a special pen that they tell you to buy, and you write your notes just like you would on a pencil and paper. And when you're done, you use the rocket book out, you scan the page, and immediately goes into a PDF in the Google Drive folder of your choice, or Dropbox, or in OneDrive. It's all up to you. And then if you use a special pen, if you buy the unlimited notebook, which costs about $40 to $50, when you're done, all the pages are done, take a cup of coffee and your rocket book, put it inside, put your coffee mug on top of it, set it for 5 minutes, and all the notes go away, and you can reuse it. And all those notes are then stored digitally in the online cloud platform of your choice. What Joe did was amazing. He scanned all those symbols on the bottom, blew them up, printed them out, and then he laminates them, puts them on the whiteboard, and then draws like a rectangle. And you write on the whiteboard, and then scan it, boom. Still works like a rocket book. I'm like, dude, we might end up putting them out of business. But I have a bunch of these in my room, and put them on the whiteboards, and kids will write notes, or I'll write, kids who want to use them. I said, here, as long as you download the Rocket Book app, set up your settings, and then write your notes on the whiteboard, scan it, and you got it. Yep. You can set it as an image file or a PDF file, and it'll be saved in any of the online cloud platforms of your choice, whether it's OneDrive, whether it's Dropbox or Google Drive. You have a question? Okay, so good question. So when you're working with a rocket book,
If you have the actual notebook itself, down here you have the QR code and some symbols. And you just cross off one of the symbols when you want to send it to a certain folder. So maybe one symbol here is going to go to your science folder in Drive. So what Joe did, he scanned these, printed them out, larger, blown up, laminated them, and then he just sticks them on the wall and then writes right above it, and you draw a rectangle around it, and you scan it with the Rocketbook app, just like you would be scanning the actual notebook. You scan the whiteboard, and it works. Like, I couldn't believe it. Like, Joe's amazing. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. Yep, definitely. Definitely. That totally would work. If you want to talk more afterwards, we can strategize. Great question. So I'll give you guys another minute here to go ahead and talk and explore ways that you may use Docs, Drive, or even the Rocketbook. Find me afterwards and I'll show you. Yep. All right. Some great questions there. So here's a little app smash I'm going to share with you that combines Google Classroom, Docs, and one of my favorite Chrome extensions called Duolist. All right. So what I do for digital note-taking when I work with students, we're a Google district, so we're using Chromebooks. And on a PC or a Mac, it's very easy to split your screen. On a Chromebook, there's no built-in way to Chrome OS to split your screen, but there's a variety of Chrome extensions that will do it for you. Some people will have probably a very popular one. You'll see Tab Scissors and Tab Glue. Tab Scissors breaks them up. Tab Glue puts them back together. Duolist does all in one. That's why I prefer Duolist. If you go to the Chrome Web Store and look up Duolist, add it, it's free. And what Duolist does, it looks like this. You have your... you'll see the button up there on your extensions. It allows you to split your window at different ratios. And my kids now can do it with their eyes closed now. It's pretty impressive to see how well they picked up on it so quickly. So what I'll do, I'll push out a Google Doc in Google Classroom. I make a copy for every kid. And if I want them to take notes digitally and I want to make sure that they actually do it, I got to say it's worth points. So what I'll do, something like this, they have a reflection here. Maybe I'll give them a YouTube video to watch or an article to read. So they open up the link to their doc and then the other link to the article or video, and they split their screen, as you can see over there on the top right corner there. They're reading or watching on one side, writing their notes on the other side. There's no having to go switch back and forth to tabs. And one of the first reasons why I came up with this was because, let's be honest, the first reason why districts started getting Chromebooks was for testing. Cheap, easy way to get kids doing the online state testing. And the first year that we did testing, our kids bombed, not because they did not know the material, not because it was really bad teaching. They were completely lacking the skills to navigate the test. They didn't have the fine motor skills to drag and drop, to look at two windows at the same time. So Duolist really helped. I started really pushing Duolist for teachers to have kids split their screens so they can really get more familiar with the format of the state testing. So I kind of killed two birds with one stone here. Next year, we saw a huge jump in their scores because they were now not struggling with the format of the test. Now this gave them some really good experience navigating. So again, my students will look at a video or read on one side, take notes on the other, and again, not 1 minute was spent at the copier. I mean, a lot of times in the past, I would have printed out that graphic organizer or note-taking tool and spent an hour at the copier fighting for it, dealing with all those issues. Now, Google Classroom is done instantly. I have so much more time to reflect in my teaching practice and come up with way cooler things for kids to do. So, yes, yes. So, give you a minute here to go ahead and look up Duelist. Play around with it. If you already have it, go ahead and split your screen with it. It's built for a Chromebook. Built for Chromebooks. It does work on PCs and Macs, even though you don't really need it. But it's built for Chromebooks. If you're on an iPad, it's not going to work. So go ahead and just go ahead and play with that for about a minute and explore. And talk to somebody. Duelist is not going to work on the iPad. So, all right. Anybody check out Duelist or Rocketbook yet? It's pretty amazing. All right. So let's talk about one of my favorites, DocHub. Whenever I teach kids DocHub for the first time, I tell them that DocHub saved my life. Again, I'm being dramatic. But a few years ago, the first time I actually ever presented outside of my district was the original version of this session in a district about 30 miles from where I work. And there was an error in the paperwork for me to get paid. And the administrator from that district called me, hey, can you come in? Can you come sign the papers? I'm like, oh, I don't want to drive all the way over there. You guys messed up. I'm like, can you guys just send me the papers through email and I can sign it electronically and send it back? They're like, sure. So instead of driving through those dangerous country roads in the valley where I could have been got into an accident, a tractor might have just pulled out and nailed me. That would be the end of me. In 10 minutes, it was signed, and I got paid. So I tell kids, it saved my life. Am I being dramatic? Of course I am. So DocHub, think of it as free Adobe. Not quite Adobe, but it's free. It's free Adobe. There is a premium subscription, but you can sign PDF files digitally. You can type on the PDF files. You can't erase what's already on there, but you can type on it. Some of you are thinking right now, digital worksheets. Don't go there. Okay? Don't go there. Okay? Digital worksheets is like your first step into ed tech, but don't plant your flag there. Okay? Because digital worksheet is no different than if you made the copies on a copy machine. But there's ways that you can really do this. Marking the text is a huge push across the country, especially with the Common Core. And again, do you want to take the time to print out packets for kids? I remember when we started as a history teacher doing DBQs, document-based questions where they had to write essays based off all these primary and secondary sources. I'm printing out these 12, 13-page packets for kids. And then a lot of times the copy machine ran out of staples, so I had to staple it myself. Or if I had a brain fart and I forgot to hit collate, I'm doing that myself. So just think of the aggravation that was saved once I was able to get these documents in a digital format. I can push them out through Google Classroom as a PDF file. And DocHub will allow me to mark the text. I can circle things with the pen function. I can highlight with the highlight tool. I can make a text box and type anywhere on that PDF. I can even upload my scanned signature and sign a document with it. You can add stamps, emojis, and pictures to the and mark up the text however you need. So again, DocHub we combined with, so if you have a PDF file saved in Google Drive, when you open up the preview, it'll say open with, and it gives you a nice drop-down menu of all the PDF viewing apps that you have in there. And if DocHub's not there, just say, it says connect more apps. It says right there, connect more apps, and then you can just do a quick search. DocHub is added, and DocHub will then open up all your PDFs. So you can set it to be your default, and you can open it up with DocHub and save all your change, all your edits, your own new copy in Google Drive, and kids can turn it in that way.
save you so much time at that copy machine. I mean, I make copies maybe once a month, and I feel kind of guilty. Like, I always take a selfie next to the copy machine, and people know my spiel here. So here's a little app smash for you. So again, you start off with, a lot of this starts with Google Classroom. Google Classroom is it's not an LMS, but it's the world, as Alice Keeler says, it's the world's greatest filing system. It files everything for you. The kids don't have to even learn how to make folders. It does it for them. It's amazing. So you start off with Google Classroom, and you don't have, with a PDF, it's different than a Google Doc or a slide. You don't have to make a copy for each kid. Just give them viewing permissions. And then when they open up to view it, and they open it up with Doc Hub, now they have their own copy. So you don't have to make a copy for each kid, because if you do that, when they submit it, it's, all you're going to see is the blank version of yours. So again, that's something you need to be cognizant of if you want to push out PDF files through Classroom. Always remember, just make it view only. And when the kids open with Doc Hub, now they have their own copy, and they'll turn that into Classroom when they're finished. So real simple, open it up with Doc Hub, and the kids will then mark the text using all the various tools. Now, some of you may be thinking, well, I need to practice with this first. I need to know it. Okay, as my old buddy John Crippo says, if you don't know how to do something, you probably have 30 IT support in the room in front of you. These kids pick it up very quickly. A lot of times with EdTech, we're afraid to take risks because we feel like we have to be the expert. With Common Core and 21st Century Learning, it's more about being student-centered. Let the kids explore it. They're not afraid to take the risk with the tech that some of us are. Because remember, these kids have never known the world without the internet. We all remember before the internet, we could remember dial-up or not having it at all. These kids don't know any better, and they figure it out so quickly. So again, if you're a little hesitant about this, just take the risk, take the plunge. They will figure it out. And it never takes me long to teach a kid for the first time how to use it. They figure it out very quickly. So your app smash here is Doc Hub and Google Classroom. If you want to go ahead and, I would say, if you want to explore for the next minute, go ahead and take a look and open up a PDF file you may have saved in your drive and see if you can open it up with Doc Hub. If it does not show up as a choice, it says connect more apps. Click there and you can add it. Yes. I do. Originally, I checked out Kami. Originally, Kami didn't really integrate too well with Google Classroom. I believe it does now. But I've been using Doc Hub so much, and they upgraded it to make it a lot more friendly with Classroom. Right. So that's my preference. But if you know how to use Kami, go ahead and use it. It's virtually the same thing.
Right, okay.
So, yeah. Yes, it does. So if you open up, you'll see a download button, and then it gives you a variety of cloud platforms you can drop it into, and Google Drive is one of them. Yeah. There you go. Yep. Yep. Yeah. Yep. And the free version, you can get away with using the free version. I mean, I pay the $6 a month for it to do other things, but yeah, the free version for kids. I mean, if you can get your school to buy the license for it, the premium, you can do a lot more with it, but it's totally unnecessary.
And so this is one month.
No. Nope.
So they would do this.
So this is now their own copy now, and they're going to mark it all up. But your original PDF is safe. Yes. Well, the Hulk never gets tired of smashing. All right, Note Anywhere. This is a relatively new one for me that I kind of stumbled across a couple years ago. But Note Anywhere, really, it's think of digital sticky notes. And you can put, it's a Chrome extension. So you go to the Chrome Web Store, type in Note Anywhere. It's free. It shows up as a little kind of yellow sticky note in your extensions bar on your Chrome browser. And what Note Anywhere does, you can drop sticky notes on any website that you go to, and when you return to that website, those notes are sitting there waiting for you, and it's private just to you. So if you are logged in to Chrome on a Chromebook, on a Mac,
on a PC, as long as the kid is logged into Chrome, their notes will follow them anywhere. And it's private only to that person. So think of the application for kids to be able to take notes. Maybe you give them an article to read, and they want to take, and you want them to take notes on it, and they can easily just drop these little sticky notes, as many as they want, on any of the websites. If you go to the settings on Note Anywhere, all you got to do, it'll give you a list of all the websites that you've gone to and left notes on. So it's like it bookmarks it for you. And when you go to a website that you've left notes, where you've left the notes, you'll see a little number on the extension that shows you how many notes are on there, so you can know what to expect. So it's a great little tool. So one of my favorite little app smashes using Note Anywhere is an Easter egg activity. I totally came up with this like by the seat of my pants one day. I was actually doing a session when I thought of this. I was pretty proud of myself. So what I do, she was here earlier this week, Lisa Highfield. She's the queen of HyperDocs. And I thought of a way where I can use a HyperDoc where I have these links for kids to go out and explore. And what I've done, and I've heard people will do this a lot, is I have a student login, a general student login on Google, and all the kids are allowed to share it. So if I want to do all the same thing. So what I do, I give them the login. They all log in as the same account, either individually or as a team. And they open it up, and they get the HyperDoc, and they click on the link. Since we're all using the same account, I can leave Easter eggs. I can leave notes on these websites in which these you see the links there. So they click here, take them to a website, and I've already left the notes there as clues. That could be to extend the learning, or I put a challenge in there where if they find the Easter egg, okay, now I know where to go next. So it's a fun little game that the kids do. So it pretty much looks like this. I actually added this yesterday to this slide. I just took a screenshot of CNN.com, and I dropped a bunch of notes on there. It's free. It's really fun to use, and kids pick it up very quickly. So it's called Note Anywhere, and I'll give you guys a few minutes to go ahead and play with that one. So it's called Note Anywhere. Check out the Chrome Web Store. It's not Notes Anywhere. Note Anywhere, singular. And the little app smash is to use Note Anywhere, Google Chrome, and Docs. What's up?
What do you mean that you have to log into the same account?
Okay, so. Those notes with someone else's
right.
account. So if they're all sharing the same one, they can find them.
So you create a Gmail?
Yeah.
Just for that?
Yeah.
And then they log into their Chromebooks regularly, but
yeah.
Then they can go in and log
yeah.
in and separate?
Yeah. They log in as the one that they, so they put them in groups of three or four, and they all share a Chromebook, and they log in, and then they click on the links on the doc, and take them to the websites where I've already left these there.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Okay. So. Thank you.
Yep. I never tried that. I don't think you can. Yeah, good question. But you can share Google Keep notes like anything else in Google. I've never tried sharing a note in classroom, but you can share it like you would a doc or slides or anything else. So, good question. Yes. I'm sorry. Yeah. If you right click on the extension. I believe you go to options. Oops. It's one of those there. Oops. It's tricky sometimes. Let's see. Or note summary. There you go.
Okay.
And then it leaves you like a whole book. The list will grow. All right. You got a question? Oh yeah, it might be on a different, on an older version. Oh, go ahead and go up. It's that one there.
Yeah, no? So this has got a lot of the same, but it doesn't seem to be like,
that's the older version.
Yeah.
I'm not even sure. I'll have to go in there and update it.
Okay.
So, yeah, afterwards I'll update it, and then you'll be able to go there. Yeah. It looks like I might have left the older version of the slide deck on my website. I will, after the session, I'll update it, and then you guys will be on the same one, so I apologize. Yes. I mean, I use them not all the time, but I use them sort of regularly. I usually use it for enrichment. So when we do our RTI, the enrichment kids get to do some exploration that way. So good question. Okay, so let's get to the fun part here. We're going to start picking apart parts of my Google Innovator project. She was here. Actually, we were partying last night at karaoke. You guys know Tara Martin, the inventor of Booksnaps? You guys know anything about Booksnaps? Oh, Booksnaps are off the hook. Booksnaps combine something that kids love and something that kids traditionally don't like. They love Snapchat. They hate reading. Booksnaps smashes them together. So Tara Martin did, I was lucky to connect with her about a little over a year ago, and we did a Google Hangout. She told me all about Booksnaps, and she told me all her brain research behind it. Like, there's serious brain research. This is not just a gimmick. There's brain research behind it. Pretty much when you read with Booksnaps, it's marking the text using Snapchat. And it started off pretty much as teachers reading professional learning books, and they would, and Tara Martin showed you how to use Snapchat to find something that you read something, it resonates with you. So you circle it using Snapchat. Take a picture of the page, circle it. And then using the text function, you type a statement about what that means to you, and then you get to use the Bitmoji and the stickers and all that to back up what you wrote. So I started seeing her do that. I'm like, oh, kids would love that. And, I mean, my kids now do it, like, they can do it with their eyes closed now. But what Tara Martin says, and I blame her. I go, Tara, it takes me like 3 times long to read a book because I want a book snap at almost every page. So it takes me longer to read now, but by reading with book snaps, it really forces me to focus on things, and I start seeing things and remembering things so much differently now, and I retain information. And the same is true for kids. It's a great way to start off a unit. So some of you are thinking, well, I don't know Snapchat, or what if my kids don't have Snapchat? Never fear. Google Slides and Google Drawings to save the day. Because you can do everything on a book snap using slides and drawings. You can use the webcam to have kids take a picture of the text, or what I like to do, because I want to maximize my time, I'll get the text digitally, I'll screenshot that page and put it on a slide, put about 7 or 8 pages that I want them to read, and they book snap each page on a shared Google slide. So here's some examples for some of my students here. there we go. So on the left here, we have a sixth grader reading a book, and he circles what resonated with him. And you see where he used the text function to write a statement about what he circled. So if you notice, everything is going over the page, but you're focusing only on the part that's circled. And the text, it goes along with what was circled, and the stickers or the Bitmojis or whatever you choose to use have to back up what they write. So think of identifying claims, looking for themes. If we take a look here in the middle one, this is a recent one from about 2 months ago. One of my ELA teachers, she teaches a freshman, was doing Romeo and Juliet, and they were doing motifs. So the kids had, she had them take pictures of each page, and you had to identify motifs. They had to circle it. They had to write the statement about it, and then use images to back up what they wrote. On the right here is actually straight out of my history textbook. I have students who are, I tell them what to look for. This is one where they had to identify examples of aggression by the Axis powers in World War II. So I gave them pages that I knew were examples, and they had to find examples of aggression. So they circled it. They wrote the text across the page, and they used the stickers to go ahead and back up what they wrote. Think of how powerful that is for a kid. It's not only to have the engagement power of Snapchat. That one actually on the right is used in Google Slides. The ones on the other two are done actually in Snapchat. So good question. So Booksnaps is a great way to get started marking the text digitally and really getting kids to really comprehend better what they're reading. Sketch notes. Any sketch noters in the room? Sketch noting is fun. I remember as a young teacher collecting notes and reading what they copied for my PowerPoint. I'm like, man, they ain't learning nothing. As some of us say, one of the catchphrases we're trying to make go viral, bullets kill learning. If you notice here, I don't really have any bullets on any of my slides. I have pictures and I talk about it. I tell kids when they present, don't put bullets. You want to have some notes on a note card, have some notes on a note card. But have pictures and talk about what's up there. I tell them it makes you look smarter. But when you don't have bullets, kids are not copying. Now they have to make notes instead of taking notes. Instead of just taking what I wrote, now they have to synthesize they have to listen, synthesize what I say and write it down rather than sitting there copying. Think about this. We've probably all been there. You move a slide. Oh, no, mister, go back. I'm not done copying. He said, drive me nuts. Sketchnotes is going to leverage your ability to doodle. We all have it. We've all done it. Some of you are probably doing it right now. Well, you're bored, or maybe it just helps you organize your information. A good sketchnote, if it looks like a comic strip or a graphic novel, you've probably done a pretty good job. So it's, if you think of it as a scale, on one side you have writing, on the other side you have images. If it's more image heavy, it's a good sketchnote. I tell a rule of thumb, whenever you write on a sketchnote, should never be more than a sentence or a quick phrase. Labeling is good. Some of you are thinking, this was a sixth grade history lesson on the Punic Wars, which is, if you don't know history, Punic Wars is a series of three wars between Rome and their North African rival Carthage. And this teacher, he was an old school teacher. He'd been teaching since, I think, before I was born. He was very talented at sitting up there for an hour and lecturing. The next kids come in, repeat the lecture. The kids just write down what he says. I said, hey, have the kids sketch notes, because you're a great storyteller. You're a very talented lecturer. Okay, you give great metaphors. Well, one of the metaphors he gave during the Second Punic War was that the Carthaginian general Hannibal used elephants the same way we use tanks today. So think about that. He could have put that written as a bullet, and the kids copied it. And maybe some of them were able to memorize it and regurgitate it on a test. But no, they sketchnoted it. And this is just one. Probably more than half the class used that same symbol on their own, completely independently. This kid right here, so when it was time to review for the exam, I scanned their sketch notes, put them on my website, and the kids looked at all the sketch notes as review. Those kids did very well on that question on the Punic Wars. They were able to remember a much more powerful way to remember the information. So, again, do you need to make copies of graphic organizers? No. We talked about pencil and paper, where the brain research talks about how it's deeper learning. If the kids create their own graphic organizer, much more that way than if I give them a rigid graphic organizer that works for my brain. This is how their brain works. Exit tickets. That's a buzzword. Huge buzzword. Hold them accountable. We need to get that constant stream of formative assessment. Well, the problem with formative assessment, it's got to be done all the time, and then you have to evaluate their work and read it to really know who's getting it, who's not. But what's a big, big problem, especially with English learners? Listening and speaking. Okay, I can print out little slips of paper for them to write little quick reflections, and they hand it to me before they leave, and after class they can review it to see, okay, so-and-so got it, so-and-so didn't. But I have to read it. And I might get a paper cut. Who likes those? Flipgrid. We have any Flipgrid people here? Flipgrid threw an awesome party on Thursday night. It was fun. Anyways, but Flipgrid, if you're not familiar with Flipgrid, is... if you use the free account, you can have kids respond using the webcams on their devices to maximum 90-second videos where they speak. So you write the prompt and they respond with a spoken video. And some kids are like, oh, I don't want to look at my face. They have filters. Well, they could put a sticker over their face. So you have the kids who really don't want to look at themselves. I tell them, just turn the thing around and talk. As long as I can hear you, I want to hear you speak it. Because a lot of kids, either if they're special needs, they can't even hold a pen, but they can talk. An EL can't find the words in English, but they can't write it out in English, but they can speak it. So really leverage what they can do, not what they can't do. And a Flipgrid is so much more fun to evaluate. I love it when I have Flipgrids and I just, all right, so I'm just going to watch their videos and listen. I can hear them, their understanding so much better through their spoken word rather than just reading something they wrote. Quick question. Yes. Flipgrid is works really well with a phone. The app is free, or they can do it through their mobile browser. Good question. So Flipgrid is a very easy way to really maximize your efficiency when dealing with exit tickets. So we're coming down to the, man, I'm pretty good, right on time. Wow, that's the best I've ever done with this one. So again, my name's Adam. I'm a technology integration coach from Cutler Rossi. I want to thank you for coming out and having fun with me on a early on a Saturday morning, and hopefully you've learned a thing or two on how you can ditch that copier. Thank you very much. If you have any questions, I'll be